The Kudzukian Network presents Riffin on Jazz with your host, Howard Robertson and Malvin Massey.
Sonny Rollins.
You got to improve, man. You got Coltrane and Ornette Coleman and these boys coming up. You better get your stuff together.
Mr. Miles Davis.
White people are funny. They, in America, they thought that I just woke up one morning and had the blues and started playing the trumpet. But it don't go like that, and you can't explain that to them.
Miles was able to make something that was wrong into something that was right.
Now they know. I'm not an accident.
Riffin' on Jazz.
Hello and welcome to Riffin' on Jazz. I'm Howard Robertson.
And I'm Malvin Massey.
And you know, Riffin' on Jazz is your weekly visit with friends talking about the music that we love.
The classic African-American art form called jazz.
Malvin!
How you doing, my brother?
All right, man. Glad you showed up again.
Yeah,
thanks
I made it.
Thanks for coming.
I was putting my blanket lights out.
Lights on the bushes. Today, we are talking about jazz goats. Yes.
That sounds like an insult, man.
Not Billy. Not as in Billy.
It sounds like an insult.
G.O.A.T.s stands for Greatest of All Time, which means we're going to talk about some of the greatest jazz artists of all time. And we're going to start with the Blue Note label, Kenny Barron.
The man is still blowing it out.
Yes.
Thank you.
2018 release, Concentric Circles, the one and only Mr. Kenny Barron.
See, most people would have thought that that was an old tune.
I know. It's soon called DPW, as a matter of fact, one okay. that he wrote.
Okay.
For Blue Note label.
Yes. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about GOATs, jazz GOATs, greatest of all time, the greatest record labels, jazz record labels of all time. And Malvin, we're going to talk about during a time that you and I remember very, very vividly and very, very fondly, when record labels like Blue Note were literally like sports teams. They were literally like professional sports teams because each label had a full roster of artists.
Yeah.
And the whole label had a certain character and a certain feel and all of that. And Blue Note is probably the most legendary one.
And we're
right?
talking about jazz labels, but this was something that went on with all the labels. When you were working
absolutely.
At Stax,
absolutely,
that was part of your job at Stax.
Stax had its own character and whatnot that was different from Motown. Stax didn't want to be confused with Motown. Motown didn't want to be confused with Philly International or any of the other labels. Everybody had their own thing, and everybody had their own roster of acts.
Okay.
Uniquely.
But on the blues, on the jazz side, it was Blue Note that was one of the first that started with straight up jazz all the time. That's what they did with the jazz. And the greatest artists came through there.
Absolutely.
I mean, everybody
absolutely.
Was on Blue Note. Goodness, Grant Green, Hank Mobley, Wayne Shorter, Jimmy Smith, Horace Silver, Miles, of course, Freddie Hubbard, Lee Morgan.
Right. Right.
All
right.
of these cats on Blue Note.
So we're going to go from one great to the next, and we're going to come back and we're going to interchange and talk about all of them. But right now, we're going to one of the oldest jazz labels, probably the oldest jazz label, and that would be Columbia Records. And you're going to hear the original version of Birdland by Weather Report. Thank you. All right. Now, we have played Birdland before on this program.
Hey, recently, when we did the show about Q, because of the version that he did that involved rappers talking about all the artists who were still alive at the time.
But you say that we've never played the original Weather Report version until just now.
Just now. And that one was the quintessential jazz fusion song of 1977.
I got you using that word. I said I ain't gonna use it
anymore.
I use it too much,
man. They called it jazz fusion then,
yes,
though.
Yes.
And Weather Report and that Birdland track, which made the song, was Alex Acuna, mm-hmm, Manolo Bedrena, Jaco Pastorius, Joe Zawinul,
right,
Wayne Shorter. That was the guys.
Now, talking about these labels, GOATs, greatest of all time, the greatest jazz record labels of all time. Talking about these labels, as legendary as Blue Note was, or as popular as and prominent as Blue Note was with jazz, Columbia was historic and legendary.
It kind of started the whole thing.
Man, I'm going to name some artists who all recorded on Columbia, beginning with Billie Holiday, Louis Armstrong, Bessie Smith, Benny Goodman, let's see, Frank Sinatra, kind of folks.
Columbia,
man.
Now, one thing about that,
Chet Baker, Dave Brubeck,
when we talk about Columbia,
Sarah Vaughan.
We brought Columbia in when we were talking about Aretha Franklin,
mm-hmm,
because they got her started in jazz. That's how when she started.
Right.
Columbia turned around after a while, and they started going more commercial. They sort of backed off of jazz.
Right.
And they started recording artists, you know, as
they did everybody.
Simon and Garfunkel, Bruce Springsteen,
yes,
and all
yes,
of them started
yes,
to be on Columbia.
Yes.
But this started off originally with jazz.
They were a multi-genre company, and again, and they were big. They were huge. Columbia was huge. So we go from that to a smaller one that is still, you know, again, very, very noted for jazz and its jazz players. And we're going to tell you who else recorded on this label, which is Riverside, in addition to this next guy that you're going to hear from. That would be Jimmy Heath doing Easy Living.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's from the Heath Brothers Jazz Family CD. They just released that, 2012, I think, somewhere around in 2015.
2012?
Yeah. I mean, and that's something cool, too, about these labels and these artists that we're dealing with, some of these artists that we're dealing with right now, is that they're still alive.
Yeah.
The artists are. And that's been an argument and a difficulty and something that's in discussion in a lot of jazz quorums right now,
mm-hmm.
that we, of course, we love and respect the artists who got us started,
right.
who got it all going. But we can't keep dwelling on them. We got to remember that the new people
stuff.
Are coming up and,
yeah.
and we're
yeah.
working on it.
But the release is new, but the Heath Brothers, Heath Brothers go way, way back. But that's a reflection of Riverside Records, which was based in New York, as most of these labels are. And Riverside had, among others, Thelonious Monk, Cannonball Adderley, Bill Evans, Charlie Bird, Johnny Griffin, and Wes Montgomery. Yes.
Major players, man.
Major players. Are you drinking tonight?
Yeah. I've been
what are you
to
drinking
so.
Tonight?
It's Avalon. Da, 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 da.
I used to live on Avalon.
Yeah.
This is Avalon. This is Avalon.
Cabernet Sauvignon.
That's it. Out of California?
Yeah.
And with our glasses of Avalon, we're going to toast to life, love, and jazz. And remind you to be sure to check us out on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, TuneIn, or your favorite podcast provider. Plus, please do the easiest thing. Text RIFF, R-I-F-F, to 72,000. You are listening to Riffin' on Jazz on the Kudzukian Network, and you bet not go anywhere because we got much, much more for you. We'll be back after this.
Riffin' on Jazz.
Funking up your airwaves and jamming the good information in your ear. Once again, it's Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Funky Politics.
Hey, this is saxophonist Kirk Whalum, and you're listening to Riffin' on Jazz, powered by the Kudzukian Network.
We're riffing on jazz goats, greatest of all time.
I still think it sounds like an insult.
To be the greatest of all time.
Be a goat.
This is a goat. A billy goat, yes. We're talking about the greatest jazz labels of all time, and subsequently, the greatest jazz artists of all time. Yeah. And that brings us to one called Impulse. Remember Impulse?
Yeah.
Who stands out as an Impulse artist for you?
As a matter of fact, it kind of freaked me out that it was Ray Charles.
Ray Charles, yes.
He was on
Ray
Impulse,
Charles
yeah.
signed with Impulse after he left Atlantic.
Records, yeah.
But there's somebody else.
My man Creed Taylor.
Creed Taylor, but no.
CTI.
If I said a Love Supreme, who does that?
Oh, John Coltrane.
John Coltrane.
Yeah, that's
yes.
right. That was when he came into his thing.
Absolutely.
On Impulse.
Impulse was ABC's music label and jazz label. And
ABC Paramount Records.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Say the whole name. but so many people came out of there. Creed Taylor that you mentioned went on to become, really, really heavy in terms of CTI.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, and that's something else too, that he was a producer. And that was a big deal that he was the producer. It's like Don Watts at BMI.
He was a producer and he was the A&R director too.
Okay, yeah.
So who was that he signed that you were saying he signed?
Sonny Criss. Out of Memphis, Tennessee. I had to do that. When I was looking for the music, I had to bring Sonny. When I saw Sonny's name on there, I was like, okay, we got to use Sonny.
Sonny is a great representation of the work that they were doing at Impulse. And we're going to get into some Sonny Criss. What's it called?
It's called Steve's Blues.
We'll be right back.
From This Is Criss, Memphian Sonny Criss.
This Is Criss, I like that.
Steve's Blues, man, that's a great track. And of course, he was one of those artists on the Impulse label.
Impulse label, yeah.
Impulse was, they were innovative and they were fresh. And
Impulse, AKA the house the train built.
Yeah, yeah, you gotta say that. Yeah, Train was there. That's where he went when he left Miles, too. Or was he still with Miles?
I don't know. But you got to pay deference and respect to the one who paid the bills.
Yeah.
And that's what Train did for Impulse. And Ray Charles didn't do a bad job of it.
Well, yeah.
Yeah, because getting him over. Now, Creed Taylor was the one who signed him, too. And he brought him over from Atlantic. And the rest is history. I mean, Ray Charles made the transition from Impulse doing jazz to ABC's main label, where he did everything else. Hit the road, Jack. He did country.
R&B,
he did
R&B.
He did everything else. So
yeah, that's something else. So, you know, again, Creed Taylor, man. This cat is a legend.
Right, right.
And that label is a legend, too.
And that's going to move us to another label, historic legendary label called Verve.
From Norman Grant.
Norman Grant.
Everybody knows
that's
Norman
right.
Grant. Verve is one of those labels that's still going strong right now. And we're going to talk about all these great artists that were on Verve and have been on Verve.
Like Charlie Parker.
Yeah, for one.
Like Bird.
But we got to listen to the Verve Jazz Ensemble. We're going to listen to the Verve Jazz Ensemble. Tis Autumn.
These are young cats?
Yeah, relatively young. Well, they're younger than us.
Everybody's younger than us, Malvin Massey.
Man, kids, we'll tell y'all about them. Check out Tis Autumn. We'll be right back. Verve Jazz Ensemble.
Yes,
that's some of my favorite guys.
Represent Verve Records, and they have such legendary roster of artists that, you know, it's too many. All I got to say is Charlie Parker, Ella Fitzgerald, and
Nina Simone,
and
Billie
Oscar
Holiday,
Peterson.
Oscar Peterson.
That's all we got time for.
Yeah.
We want to say thank you very, very much for the kind words and you guys responding to us on our Facebook page and whatnot. And we want to send shout outs today to my baby from Memphis, Tennessee. She is a fashionista and she lives in Atlanta. Now her name is Lena Turner.
Right on. And then want to acknowledge Mary Lott from St. Louis, Missouri.
Then there's Adam Schwartz from Englewood, New Jersey.
Linda Swing. Is that Swing? Linda
Sway.
Swing and Sway. Linda Sway from Paris.
And my man, Roy Royal Jackson from Chi-Town. Want to thank you guys for listening to Riffin. Keep it up. Please don't leave us out here. And thank you for your response. And we're going to take a little break here and ask you to stay with us. We'll be back with more Riffin' on Jazz on the Kudzukian Network after this.
It's Riffin' on Jazz.
Hi, conversation.
Elliot Perry, otherwise known as Sox.
Man, thank you. How you guys doing?
Mr. Earl the Pearl Monroe.
Hey, thank you. Nice to be with you guys.
Glad to have Mr. Allen Houston.
Trying to stay warm up here in New York.
I hear you. Personality extraordinaire, Mr. Scoop Jackson.
I appreciate the encore.
Hi, conversation. The Kudzukian Network.
Kudzukian. Welcome back. We are Riffin' on Jazz, and we are talking about the GOATs. Still think that's an insult. It is ripping on the greatest jazz record labels of all time.
That's right.
And
no insult whatsoever.
No.
Only
so,
positive, only complimentary.
And when you mentioned it, bringing this up, so we're going to do, this is part one.
Mm-hmm.
We're
going to
do another part.
Yeah, because there's so many that we haven't been able to get to.
Yeah.
But and some that you, as they say, some so nice you got to do them twice.
Exactly.
Like Columbia, like where we are now. Now,
yeah.
I related the record labels like sports teams. And that's it's a natural parallel to me, Malvin.
Okay.
Because these labels were in strict competition like sports teams to each other. And they each had a roster of very, very famous artists. And they, quite frankly, competed tooth and nail to sell more records than the other one. Columbia would have been akin to a dynasty, like in football, yeah. Like some people would consider the Packers or the Dallas Cowboys,
yeah,
at one time, or somebody like that, a dynasty. That's what Columbia was, because they were so deep and they had so very many fantastic,
yeah,
artists, including the ones that we've got coming up, that we're going to feature coming up. Talk about that.
Yeah, and we did Birdland from Columbia because,
yeah,
that was
Weather Reports Birdland, yeah.
Original belt work, and that was like fusion. They were on the forefront of that.
Right.
Now we're talking about where they were, they still, where they continue to be and where they were originally,
mm-hmm,
with Count Basie.
The Count Basie Orchestra was on the Columbia label and may still be,
yeah,
on
the
Sony.
New CD,
I don't know.
Yeah, Sony is, I think it might be affiliated. We're going to look that up.
Okay. What are we doing from Count Basie?
All of Me from 1965.
Yes. Thank you.
all of me.
Count Basie Orchestra.
The Columbia
record label.
Yeah. They are. It just shows how diverse these labels have been, too, over the years. In the as diverse as jazz is.
You know, I miss that. I miss that. You know what? I miss that. I'm open to say and willing to say, you know, I don't understand nor do I particularly like the state of the record industry right now. It's wide open. It's the wild, wild west. Technology has blown the doors open, and everybody's doing everything. And so we don't receive our music like we used to.
No, and the distribution has changed so much. Now it's all mostly digital. And at one of the conferences I went to, it was discussed that in the next 5 to maybe 15 years or even less, there will be no more CDs. Mm. All the music will be downloaded off digital platforms.
So I think that where there's less competition and where there's less activity in terms of that, I don't think the quality mm-hmm. is there. So, but we're talking about jazz, greatest of all time, and that's going to bring us to coming back to Blue Note, but it's not the Blue Note of yesteryear.
Exactly.
It is the Blue Note of the contemporary Blue Note. And most people have not and don't understand, have not connected the dots relative to Blue Note. But Blue Note absolutely has some contemporary artists, and we're about to hear from one.
And you know, one of the newest artists on Blue Note is Gregory Porter.
Gregory Porter absolutely is a Blue Note artist. And this young lady that took the world by storm with this cut that you're about to hear is one also. Her name is Norah Jones.
I waited till I saw the sun. I don't know why I didn't come. I left you by the house of fun. Don't know why I didn't come. I don't know why I didn't come. When I saw the break of day, I wish that I could fly away. Instead of kneeling in the sand, catching teardrops in my hand, my heart is drenched in wine. But you'll be on my mind forever. Out across the endless sea, I would die in ecstasy, but I'll be a bag of bones driving down the road alone. I didn't come.
from her CD, Come Away With Me. That was from 2002. Norah Jones.
Pretty girl, Laura. Yeah. Norah, not Laura.
She took the world by storm with that, though, yeah. Man. Everybody played that to death.
Absolutely.
And that was like Blue Note saying, hey, we're stretching out here.
See what you learn listening to Riffin. I know you guys did not know that was on the Blue Note label.
Yeah. You know, they've got a new one, Candace Springs, young lady out of Nashville.
Mm-hmm.
She's good.
On Blue Note?
On Blue Note.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, now that's going to bring us back to Verve. Now, so many of you don't realize that Verve was the label, the initial label, for this next gentleman. Now, this guy is what I call a hybrid artist. He's one of the greatest of all time because, in a lot of ways, he mimics the greatest of all time. I call him hybrid because he is a cross between the vocals of Nat King Cole and
who he admired,
the guitar virtuosity of who?
Wes Montgomery.
Wes Montgomery, you dadgum Skippy. And I could be talking about nobody other than George Benson, which we're going to play going out.
And this is going to show a collaboration between these labels because this is George Benson with the Count Basie Orchestra.
Absolutely.
Big
absolutely.
Boss band from, when was that? That was 2011.
Without a song. Malvin, it's been real, my brother.
I appreciate you.
Once again, we have been thrilled and honored to bring you another episode of Riffin' on Jazz. We have been riffing on GOATs, the greatest of all time. And we ask you to please be back with us. Be safe. Be here. Be a part, engaged in everything that you do. And we look forward to seeing you and hearing you and feeling you next week.
Because we're keeping jazz alive.
That's it. On behalf of myself, Howard Robertson.
Malvin Massey.
Y'all take care.
Riffin' on Jazz. Executive produced by KUDZUKIAN. Co-host by Howard Robertson and Malvin Massey Jr. Music curation by Howard and Malvin. And recorded at KUDZUKIAN Studios. Riffin' on Jazz. Part of the KUDZUKIAN Network.
Without a song, the day would never end. Without a song, the road would never bend. When things go wrong, a man ain't got a friend without a song. That field of corn would never see a plow. That field of corn would be deserted now. A man is born, but he's no good no how without a song. I got my troubles and woes, but sure as I know, the Jordan will roll. I'll get along long as a song is strong in my soul. I'll never know what makes the rain to fall. I'll never know what makes the grass so tall. I only know there ain't no love at all without a song. Without a song, the day would never end. Without a song, the road would never bend. When things go wrong, a man ain't got to.
of a song. That field of corn would never see a plow. That field of corn would be deserted now. A man is born, but he's no good, good, no how without a song. I got my troubles and woe, but sure as I know, the Jordan will roll. I'll get along, long as the song is strong in my soul. I'll never know what makes the rain to fall. I'll never know what makes the grass so tall. I only know there ain't no love at all without a song. Without a song. Without a song.